I am Attila Turzo, an international master and chess coach. In this video, I would like to share with you the rule of the game of chess. The game of chess is a thousands years old game. The history of chess is not really known. Some researches said it's originated from Zoroaster, from the Middle East, from several thousand years ago, and from there it went to India, and from India it came back to the Middle East around 1000 after Christ, and around in the 15th century it went to Europe, and then it became a popular game. It was first the game of the kings, but then it started to be a game of the everyday man. It's a table game. It played on a square shaped table which consists of 64 squares, 32 light colored square and 32 black colored square. On the board there are 16 pieces for the player who plays with the white pieces and 16 pieces for the player who plays with the black pieces. There are 6 different pieces for each player. In the corner stands the rooks, 2 rooks for white and 2 rooks for black. Right after the rook stands the knight, 2 knights for white and 2 knights for black. After the knights stands the bishops, 2 bishops for white and 2 bishops for black. After the bishops stands the king and the queen. The queens are always stands on their own color, so the white queens stands on the light square and the black queen stands on the dark square, and on the remaining square stands the kings, the white king and the black king. In front of the pieces stands the pawns. In front of the 8 pieces stands 8 pawns for white. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 pawns for white, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 pawns for black. So we have the board and we have the pieces. The goal of the game is the capture of the enemy king. So if the white pieces can capture the black king, then white wins. If black captures the white king, then black wins. Actually, before the capture of the king, the game is finished. So when there is a situation when one of the king cannot escape from being captured, then we say the king is checkmated and the player won. The pieces have different movements, and I would like to share you the different movements of the pieces. The king can move on each direction 1 square, so it can go forward, backward, right and left, and it can also go diagonally up right, up left, down right and down left. Just 1 square always. This is how the kings move. In the middle of the board, the king can move to 8 different squares. On the edge of the board, it can move to 5 different squares. In the corner, it can move only 3 different squares. So, 3 squares from the corner, 5 squares from the edge of the board, and 8 squares from the center. So this shows immediately in the center or closer to the center, it has more possibilities. It's an important idea in the chess game. We try to put our pieces in the middle of the board because there they have more possible moves. Our next piece is the queen. The queen can move the same way as the king, but it has unlimited possibilities of the movement. So it can go to forward, backward, right and left, and unlimited number of squares until it not reach an own piece. It cannot move to the square where there is an own piece, or it doesn't reach an opponent piece. Until that, it has unlimited possibilities. So if the board is empty or there are no pieces on these squares which where I draw the arrows, the white queen has several possibilities. It has actually 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 on vertically, 7 squares horizontally, and diagonally it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 on this diagonal, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 on the other diagonal. So 3 times 7, that's 21, plus 6, 27 possibilities has the queen from the middle of the board. If we move the queen to the direction of the corner, then its power will decrease. Horizontally and vertically it still has 7 and 7 possible moves, and also one of the diagonals still remains 7 possibilities, but the diagonal which changed, this diagonal was in the previous example, that was 6 possibilities, but in the next one but now that's 4, so it's decreased the power by 2 possible moves. So from 27, it goes to 25 possible moves. We continue to put the queen closer to the corner. As you look, vertical and horizontally, it still have 7 and 7 possibilities, and this long diagonal another 7, so that's 21. But in this short diagonal, it has only 2 possible moves, instead of the 4 moves which was possible last time, so it's even decreased now from 25 to 23 possible moves. In this position, the queen reached the corner. From the corner, horizontally and vertically, it has still 7 possible squares, but as you look, there are only 1 diagonal now for the queen with 7 possible squares. So it's reached its minimum potential of 21 available squares. As you looked from the center, with each square closer to the corner decreased its power by 2 possible moves. So this shows, if possible, try to put the queen also in the center, because it will have more possible moves. Our next piece is the rook. Let us look at the possibilities for the rook. The rook moves horizontally and vertically. So vertically it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 possibilities, and horizontally 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So it has 14 possibilities from the center. So compared to the queen, it doesn't move diagonally, just vertically and horizontally, as long as he wants, as long as it's not meeting an own piece or an opponent piece. So from the center it has 14 possibilities. If we put a rook to the edge of the board, it will have actually still have 14 possible squares, 7 vertically and 7 horizontally. So if you looked, it did not make any change the number of possibilities as it moved from the center to the edge of the board. If we put the rook to the corner, it will have still 7 possibilities vertically and 7 possibilities horizontally. So it shows the special situation about the rook. It's no matter where it stands on the board, it has the same number of possibilities. So you don't need to put the rook to the center to have its maximum potential. It's anywhere actually on the board, it has good potential. It's more important about the rooks to try to put them on positions where it will be not meeting an opponent or its own pieces. So try to put them on clear files, open files, where it has its full potential. The next piece is the bishop. The bishop moves on diagonals, both moves on the right top, the left top, the left down and the right down diagonal. From the center it has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 possibilities on these diagonals, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 possibilities on those diagonals. So from the center it has 13 different possible moves. If we move it closer to the corner, then let us count how much will be his potential. In this long diagonal will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, still 7 possibilities, but the other diagonal will be smaller, the number, 1, 2, 3, 4, it was 6 in the other diagonal, this was the last diagonal, it was 6, it was longer. So the potential of the bishop decreased by 2 possible moves when it went closer to the center, closer to the corner from the center. When we go one square closer to the corner, the long diagonal remains the same, gives us 7 possibilities, but as you look, the other diagonal became really short, just 2 possible squares from there, so 9 possible squares from this situation for the bishop. When the bishop reaches the corner, then it will have only 1 diagonal possible for him, and it has 7 different moves. So as we looked, it started with 13 possibilities and it went from 13, 11, 9 and 7 moves, how it went from the center to the corner. So it shows us the bishop also better if it's closer to the center, so try to put it there if it's possible. The next piece is the knight, which has a very special movement. It's called like an L-shaped movement, because like the letter of L, as I will draw it for you, this is his movement, but it actually jumps. So from the square where it stands, it jumps to the end, the other end of the L-shaped square. Also, another way to explain its movement is it moves 2 squares like a rook. So it moves up, down, right or left, 2 squares when you make the move, and then it turns left or right, so it can move also here, or when it moves to the direction of the right, it turns right and then it goes 1 square down and jumps there, or it goes jumps up 1 square, or it's also possible when it goes two squares up and then turns right or turns left and jumps there, or when it goes two squares left and then turns up and jumps there, or turns down and jumps there. This is a very special piece because it can jump or fly, so which is important to the squares where it jumps. There should be not an own piece, because then it cannot move there, or it can be an opponent piece because then it can capture the piece. But on the other squares, it's possible to place an opponent piece. For example, if I place here a rook, it can still jump to here, the knight, so goes to and then turn, because it jumps, so actually it can move in front of those pieces. So even there is, looks like it's a wall for the knight, but it can still fly two squares up and then turn left or turn right and move there, because it jumps up on the opponent's piece or its own pieces. So from the center, let us calculate how much difference moves he has. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So from the center, the middle of the board, it has 8 different possible moves. If we put the knight one move closer to the corner, we count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Still 8 possible squares to move. So from the center and one square closer to the corner, the number of the moves are same. The number of the possible moves are same for the knight. If from that square we move the knight closer to the edge of the board, then we will look some specialties, because now we cannot count two moves up, just one, so there will be moves which are not possible anymore for the knight. It can still move right and then turn up and down, that two possible squares. Can go down two moves and turn right and left at 3 and 4. It can go left and then turn up and down, that's two more. So it still has 6 possibilities when we moved to closer to the edge of the board. If we move it to the edge of the board, then as we will look, it's even losing more possibilities, because now when we count 2 on the right, we cannot count up, just down, so that will be 1 possibilities, and then left, and then only again just down, so that's 1 other possibilities, then count 2 down and left and right, that's 2 more, so then it has 4 possible moves when it's on the edge of the board, but still relative close to the center. If we move the knight a little bit closer to the corner, but it's from the edge, we will look, it has 1, 2, 3, 4 possible moves, so the same number of moves when it was on the edge, on the last example, but closer to the center. So it's kind of a balanced. It's closer to the corner, but also a little bit closer to the center. So it's same number of moves, 4. If we move the knight now even closer to the corner square, because it's on the edge, then as we look, it will decrease even more its potential, because it will be 1, 2 possibilities, and from the other direction will be the third one. So no more possibilities, just 3 possible moves when the knight is on the edge and just near the corner. If we put the knight in the corner, then it reaches its minimum potential, because it has only 1 and another one, so 2 possible moves. As we looked, The knight reached its minimum potential in the corner and its maximum potential in the center. So it shows, if possible, we try to put the knight in the squares of the center, so it will have more possibilities there. The last piece to explore is the pawn. It has special movements. From its starting position, it can move forward one square or two squares, like the rook, forward, up. So it can move here or here. After its first move, it's always moved one square forward. But it's important, it can only move forward if there are no opponent or nor his pieces sits front of him. Because if there are any of the pieces from its own, for example, if there is another pawn, then it's blocked, so it cannot move anymore. Or if there is an opponent piece, like a pawn, then it's also blocked and it cannot move anymore until the piece which blocks it will be removed by another piece, or it moves away. The movement and the capture is different for the pawn. It can move forward, up, but to capture, its diagonal is actually diagonally. So, example, it moves kind of like a bishop, but just one squares diagonally upright or diagonally up left. So this pawn can capture the rook by moving on that square and removing the rook from the board. It also can capture this queen by removing the queen and putting the pawn instead of that. So the pawn moves up and captures diagonally up, just one square. There is a special capture for the pawns, which we call en passant. I will show you a normal capture for the black pawn. If the white pawn would move just one square, then the black pawn can just simply capture by removing the white pawn and putting up. As we look, the black pawn captures diagonally up, as this is his move up from his point of view. This is just a normal capture. But there's a special capture if the white pawn moves just from the starting position, that's very important, from the starting position moves not one, but two squares, which is only possible from the starting position, so it moves just near the black pawn. Then in this turn, black is possible to steal the pawn, can capture that white pawn in a very special way. It's called en passant, which moves in the middle of the way. So in the middle of this, the way of this pawn, it's here where I draw that arrow, it can capture. So it moves like if it would be only moving just one square. So we put the black pawn on that square, which it would originally capture, and then we can remove the white pawn this way. It's a very special way of capture. So the white pawn moves two squares just near the black pawn, and as it would just move to one square, the black pawn moves behind the pawn, just his normal capturing move, and can remove the white pawn. There is one important rule about this. If black not captures now this white pawn but moves something else, example with this pawn, then white also moves something else, and then again black turns, he cannot capture the pawn which moved on the last move just near him. Only that en passant capture only possible in that move when it's available. So just now or not. Right now or never ever. Example, if here black plays with this pawn up, then there is a possibility for white to make the en passant move, like if it would you just play it here, then the white pawn would move to instead of the black pawn, so black pawn would be disappearing and we can put the white pawn there. But the same feel happen if the black pawn just moves two squares from its starting square, and then the white pawn moves behind him, like it, if the black pawn would only just run, and then it can be the black pawn would be removed. This is the move which is called en passant. The pawns have one another very special skill which we call promotion. This is actually the goal of the life of the pawns, to be promoted something else, something bigger, something stronger. The pawns can go forward from the starting square, it can go one or two squares, and then just moving one square forward and forward until they reach the end of the square, end of the board, the first rank of the opponent, and when they arrive there, then they can be promoted to any of the pieces which white had, so they can be promoted to a queen, they can be promoted to a rook, a knight, or a bishop. So the promotion, how we make it, so we move the pawn to the final square, and there we can decide to promote it to a queen, to a rook, a bishop, or a knight. We remove the pawn and we put instead the new piece. And there is a special rule which is sometimes players don't know well, especially beginners. So we can have as much as queens, as much pawns promoted. So even we can have 9 queens on the board if we have our original queen and other 8 pawns we will promote. So not only the pieces which was captured came back to the board, but we can ask for other queens from another board. So we can have even 9 queens, as much number of queens, bishops, rooks or knights we have, as much we promote. And after this move, like the black pawn would also reach the white first rank, and it can be also promoted to any of the pieces which it wants. There is one more special move which was made by two pieces who work together, the king and the rook. We call it castle. The importance of castle is made by the movement of the pawns, because most of the time the pawns in the middle goes up, and then it opens the way for the opponent pieces to attack the white king from different directions, and many times it would be good for the king to go behind the pawns, and this very special move make that possible. Actually, the castling made together by the king and one of the rooks. The way to make the move is you move your king, actually very special, because normally it just moves one square on one of the directions, but this time when you make the castle, you can move two squares to the direction of the rook and move there, and then the rook jumps to the other side of the king. This we call a castle. Castling. So white made castling. If you go and look it again, so the white king goes two squares to the direction of the rook, and the rook jumps to the other side of the king. As you look, it's possible to move also this to the right side and on the left side. Because as you look, the right side, between the rook and the king, there are only 2 squares available, and the other side is 3 squares, so There's one side which is shorter, so we call that the short castle. Then we move to the right direction now with the White King, the short castle. And the other direction, we can do the same type of move. The king moves again two squares to the direction of the rook, and the rook will jump to the other side of the king. There are rules which we need to follow about castling. First of all, the king which wants to castle could not move before, because if it's moved away and then moved back to the square, then it's not allowed to castle anymore. Also, if the rook moved from the starting square and moved back, then it's again not allowed to castle anymore with that rook. So the king and the rook should have its very first square, it's not moved before. The next rule. The king cannot be in check. So example, this white bishop is attacking the black king, so the black king is in a check, so it's under attack, so it cannot castle. So from check we cannot castle. The second, between the rook and the queen should be all squares empty. So that's not in this case, because the knight is in the way, so the castling is not possible for white on that side. For example, if the knight would move out to here, then the castling would be possible, because there would be no pieces between the rook and the queen. So the second rule, the next rule was, there should be empty squares between the king, cannot be in check. The next one, the king when it's castle, like it would go to this direction, two squares, it cannot go and jump on the fire. So, because the black bishop is attacking the square, which would be in the way of the white king when he tried to go to castle, that's not possible. And one more idea, it's also cannot castle to a check. So example, now because of this bishop is attacking this square, so the white king could not castle on the long side, because then when it would reach the second square on the long direction, then it would be in a checks. So actually in this position white cannot castle on that direction because of that bishop, the other direction because of this bishop. And the black king also cannot castle because he is in check. But if you remove this bishop, then white can castle on the short side. And if we remove the other black bishop, then white can also castle on the long side. But it's important, it's not the rook and the king are not moved already. Or in this situation, black could castle only if first he saw the problem of this check. So if he would move between with this pawn the white bishop and the king, then it would be no more check, because the pawn would block, and then in the next move would be possible for black to castle. One more important idea about castling. The king cannot jump over the fire of the attacking piece, so that's not possible castle, but the rook can jump. So example, the bishop kept attack this fire, but it's not preventing white from castling, because the king can move two moves to the direction of the rook, and the rook can jump over the attacked square of the bishop. So let's review the rules of the castling. It's important the king and the rook which wants to castle not moved before. This is the first one. The second one, the king cannot be in check. The third one, the king cannot go over the check, and fourth one, it cannot castle into a check. If all these possibilities are removed, these barriers, then the king can castle freely, like in this position, white and black can both castle on the short side and on the long side. Because the rooks and the kings are not moved, they are not in check, they will not move into check, and they not move over the fire, any of those squares. So those castles are possible. We need to discuss three more ideas. What is a check? What is a checkmate? And what is a stalemate? A check is a situation when the king is under attack. For example, if the white queen moves here, then because as you look, its potential is like this direction, it can could move in the next move. So this is threatening in to capture the black king. So we call the black king is in check, because it is under attack and would be captured in the next move if it would not move. There are also other checks in this position. Example, this is also a check, because then now from this direction the queen attacks the black king and threatening to capture. But it's only a check because the black king has move to escape. Actually, there's 1, 2, 3 different ways to escape from the check, because then in the next move the white queen cannot capture. So if we say a check is an attacking move which still gives the possibility of the black king to escape. The checks can be defended several ways. One way is to go out of the check. Then there's other possibilities. Example, if the knight is here and the same check, now the black king can move away, but also a possibility to move the knight in between the queen and the king as a shelter. So now it protects the king from the check. So one way was moving the king. The second way is moving a piece between the king and the piece which gives the check. And there is a third way, when there is a piece which can actually capture the piece which gives the check. So example, the queen gives the check here, and there is this black bishop which can capture the queen, so it removes the problem of the black king. So in this situation, black can defend against the check three different ways. One is to move away the king, the second is move the knight between the queen and the king, and the third one is capturing the queen. So a check is a move when we are threatening to capture the opponent king. What is a checkmate? A checkmate is a move, actually the checkmate is a check, like example this is a check, when the opponent's king cannot escape from being captured. Because now the queen is threatening to capture the black king, but it's everywhere it moves it will be captured. If it moves there, then the queen can capture. If it moves here, then still the queen can capture. If it moves there, then the queen can capture. And if it moves to the direction of the king, then the opponent queen king would capture. So it cannot move there. So that's a rule. Actually, the kings cannot move to each other, because then the king which moved closer to the other, it would be captured. So this is a checkmate. So this move, this check is a checkmate, because the king cannot move out of the checks, and also it has no piece to move in between the check giver and the king, and also nobody can capture the queen which gives the check. So this is an easy check to give, and this is the checkmate. So there is one other checkmate here. The white queen moves here. This is also a checkmate. It cannot be captured by the king, because the white king defends, and also it cannot move on the left, because the queen controls that square and captures. Also, it cannot go diagonal, because it captures, and cannot move also in this way, because they will be both captured. So in this situation, there are two checks which actually are checkmates, and there are other checks which are just checks, not checkmates, because the black king can go out. So we discussed about check and checkmate. So all checkmates are checks, but not all checks are checkmates. And there is one more idea which we should discuss, is we call a stalemate. It's not a checkmate, it's a stalemate. Because when somebody gives a checkmate, then it wins the game. So the goal of the chess game is to give a checkmate for your opponent's king. So capture the opponent's king. But there is a possibility when the game actually is not won by anybody, so both white and black gets a half point, but it's got stalemate. I will show you a stalemate situation. When the white queen moves to here, then actually the black king is not in a check, so this is really important during the stalemate. So there is no check, so it's not attacked by anybody, but also it's all its possible squares where it moves would be in a check. So it cannot move there and there because of the queen, also here because of even the king and the queen. It cannot move here because of the king, and cannot move there because of the queen. So all potential squares are attacked, but it's not in a check. That's the definition of the check, of the stalemate, when the king is not in a check, but it's all its possible squares are attacked. And if there are other pieces on the board, other black pieces, it's very important, they should be blocked. So example, there is one more piece for black, a pawn, but it cannot be moved because of the other pawn. So they cannot move. That's very important. So example, he would be there a knight, but there would be also pawns which would block its situation, then still cannot move. But now actually the black king could move to f8, so it would be not a stalemate, only if there would be one other piece, example a bishop here, which would attack that square. So now this is still a stalemate situation, because the black king cannot move because of the check. Of all the squares are controlled, so it would be in a check, but he is not in check, and all other pieces are blocked, they cannot move. So the goal of the game of chess is giving a checkmate, so creating a situation where your opponent's king is attacked and you will be able to capture it in the next move, no matter what he does. Our different pieces has different potential, different value, and there is a system which used generally nearly by most of the players, which I would like to show you. In this system, the value of one is called a pawn, so the one cost 1 point. The next one, the knight, we say one knight cost equivalent with 3 pounds, so it costs like 3 points. 1, 2, 3 points. So one knight is like equivalent with with 3 pawns, and actually the knight and the bishop has the same value. So also the bishop has the value of 3 points, like the knight. Then the next more valuable piece is actually the rook. The rook is like 3 pawns as a bishop plus 2. So it's actually 5 points. The value of the rook is 5. The value of the bishop and the knight is 3. The value of the rook is 5. And the next piece, which is even more valuable, is the queen, which is even more pawns. It's not just 5, but 4 more. So actually it's 6, 7, 8, 9. So the queen is 6, 7, 8, 9 points. The value of the queen is 9. The value of the knight and the bishop is 3. The value of the rook is 5. So as we look, example, rook is the same value as the knight and 2 pawns, because the knight is 3 and plus 2 pawns is 5. Or a bishop and 2 pawns, because that's also 5. A queen can be equivalent like with a knight, a rook and a pawn, because that's 9 points. Or like 2 bishops and the knight, because that's also 9 points. It's the relative value of the pieces. Of course, sometimes the queen can be stronger than those 3 pieces, or those 3 pieces can be stronger than a queen. And one piece left, the king, which has its eternal potential and power and value, because if it's captured, then the game is finished. So it's the most important and most valuable piece, which you should be guard very well. We already talked about the movement of the pieces, but we should discuss a little bit one more idea, the capture. The capture is a movement when we move our piece on the square where there is an opponent piece, and we remove it, and we move instead of that piece our piece. So this we call a capture. So example, there is a rook on the corner. We remove the bishop, the black bishop, and we put our bishop instead of that. We move our rook instead of that bishop. So this is what we call a capture. We make a legal move with our rook, but it's on the square where we would move. There is an opponent piece, so we can remove it and move our piece instead of the original piece. There is one other possibility for the pawn. Here, for the white pawn, can remove the black pawn and move instead of that square. It's also possible for the white queen. As you look, it can move forward and remove the pawn and put there. After this move, black has also possibilities to capture, because as you look, his pawn can capture the queen, removes the queen and puts instead this pawn. And now white has 2 possible captures, actually 3. The rook still can capture the bishop. Also, this knight can capture the black pawn, can move on the left and then turn up and removing the pawn. Also, the white pawn can remove the black pawn by capturing diagonally. And now the black bishop has a potential and can capture the knight, because it can move to the square of the knight, remove the knight and put there the bishop. But that bishop will be captured then by the white king, because it can move diagonally and remove the bishop. So this is the way of captures, and we should try to capture the opponent pieces, because if we have more pieces than the opponent, then most of the time easier to capture and check and then checkmate his king. So try to capture the opponent pieces and then check with the king. By the captures, you should try to be aware of the value of the pieces. Normally, after the captures, you should try to capture a more valuable piece with your less valuable piece. Example here, white would capture the pawn with the pawn, because then the black pawn would be recaptured. So white also lost the pawn, and the black also lost the pawn. That's an equal exchange. But if the white queen, which has the value of 9 points, so 9 pawns, would be capturing the black pawn, that would be a bad business for white, because black pawn can capture the queen. So black just lost the pawn, if you compare the starting position, but white lost the queen, so 1 point against 9, which would be a good business for black. So we should always have in mind when we capture something, if it would be recaptured with the opponent, then if we count the value of the pieces, who would win with that exchange. So thank you very much for your attention. Try to give your best to capture the opponent pieces and then checkmate the opponent king. Have fun, play wonderful games. Thank you very much for your attention.